Thank you very much again to the next speaker, our last speaker, Ms. Heike Frankl. Heike is Director of Validation Services in Europe at Sartorius. Heike worked for more than 19 years with Sartorius in various roles, and since the last 8 years, she has been responsible for validation services that we offer as an independent service to our customers, but also to customers that are using non-Sartorius filters, bags, or bioreactors, as we are providing this as a normal fee-for-service offering to our customers. So Heike will talk to us about, I think, the very interesting topic which many of us are very keen to learn more about: are leachables and extractables a concern in upstream processing and also in downstream processing? So once we have sorted the technology, I guess we can go ahead with that talk.
Funktioniert das?
Ja. Danke schön.
Very good. So welcome, Heike.
Thank you, Christel. Strange things. Okay, good afternoon, everybody. Also, thank you for coming from my side. We are now completely changing the topic from interesting technical and scientific things and new developments. We are raising a question regarding extractables or leachables. The question, of course, is a rhetoric question. We already heard that the use of single-use equipment is strongly increasing, strongly increased in the past years, so there cannot be a real concern. However, this subject needs to be addressed, and I would like to discuss with you how that can be done. These 10 minutes are split in 4 chapters, a little bit about the regulatory landscape regarding extractables and leachables, and a major point is, of course, the responsibilities of a vendor of single-use equipment. And one of these responsibilities is also to offer a kind of technical and validation services, what we are doing. And then finally, we will discuss some examples regarding extractables and leachables. The There are regulatory requirements, of course, to ensure the safety of drug substance and drug products, and there are also sentences in GMP guidelines to avoid that undesired impurities and substances reach a process. But there is nearly no guideline which really tells how to do that. And this ICH Q7A guideline, which you probably all know, asks us to validate critical process steps. And then the question is how to define what are critical process steps. And later we will discuss together a risk assessment criteria to identify if a plastic component is a risk for the drug product. Then we have another guideline which really clearly addresses the extractables and leachables thing. That is the EMA guideline on plastic immediate packaging material, which is a similar one compared to the FDA container closure guideline from 1999. And both these guidelines are not only focusing on final containers for final drug product, so syringes, vials, ampoules or so, but also on process containers to take active ingredient or formulated drug product. And these guidelines are calling for extractables and leachables testing and data to be submitted. Last slide about regulatory landscape. These three organizations which are listed there, PDA, PQRI, and BPSA, are not regulatory agencies, that are interest groups who are supporting the pharmaceutical industry in technical and regulatory things. And I guess that you all know these three associations. The BPSA Bioprocess System Alliance recently has already published guidance on how to deal with the extractables and leachables thing of single-use manufacturing material. Then we have PDA, which is currently working on a technical report for single-use equipment, so how to use it, how to operate it, how to overcome, for example, the extractables and leachables thing. So this report, I think, will be published by end of this year. And then we have PQRI, which is a research association, which became famous latest in 2006 when the recommendations on extractables and leachables thresholds for inhalation products was published. And this organization is now working on comparable recommendations and guidelines for parenterals and ophthalmic products. And this organization is giving clear advice and clear technical information on how to carry out studies and what threshold values or limit values could be and how to reach them. So these are under their abbreviations easily accessible in the web if you want more information. In general, there is an understanding that the validation requirements are increasing from upstream to until formulation and filling of final product, and in the other direction from preclinical to commercial production. A question to you, are there downstreamers amongst you? Okay, so all upstreamers. Okay, so that means we are here in this area. Okay, then I will try to concentrate on that. let me get back once again. Of course, vendors of not only single use, but everything of every part of equipment what is used in the biopharmaceutical industry needs to be appropriately qualified. And often these information are sufficient to do a risk assessment and, of course, most important, to make an evaluation whether a specific device is suitable for the intended use or not. And then later in the process, we may need more extensive additional product and process specific testing. Regarding information from the supplier, Sartorius products, so all kind of filters, all kind of bags, plastic bioreactors, connectors and so on, all of these devices is accompanied by a validation guide and by an extractable guide, so that are the IQOQ documents for that. And here is just a short overview of the contents of these validation guides. With regard to extractables and leachables, of course, we have to show that we do not use any toxic or hazardous materials to manufacture our things. And this is to be proven by tests, for example, USP plastic cast tests, cytotoxicity testing, NBR or TOC, and we have to ensure that the gamma irradiation is validated and the shelf life is validated and all these things. And this documentation is accessible to everybody, and that is the same with the extractables information. And we have published data there from worst case extractions using some model test solutions and worst case extraction situations. And then these extracts have been analyzed by different specific analytical methods so that we have clear information about the identity of particular extractable substances so that we or you can do a tox evaluation on that and see if there is a potential that toxic or hazardous or otherwise undesired substances may leach out of the plastic thing. In general, as already mentioned, the use of single-use equipment is increasing, and this is interestingly tremendously driven by the biopharmaceutical industry. I have never experienced before that a technology was so much driven by users of what can be done in single use and what kind of assemblies, what kind of combinations. And that means that there must be a good partnership between the vendor and the user up from the first ideas and development step. And then, of course, there is a long-term partnership to ensure that everything is provided in the quality which was agreed upon. So that means that quality documentation, change notification, and auditing and everything must be provided in order to ensure transparency and quality. And then additionally, it may be necessary that customer product and process specific testing is necessary, and for that purpose we offer validation services, which we do not do only for our products, but for other vendors' products which are also in the process line. So that makes a lot of sense and is convenient for our customers to have one source for the services. And the service program contains of microbiological testing, physical testing, shipping validation for drug product bags, for example, decontamination exercises of freeze and thaw bags, for example, and then the big portion of extractables and leachables testing, which we are offering for all kind of plastic devices. So starting with a bioreactor, silicon tubing, and ending up with a syringe or a vial where the drug product is stored in. We are taking these extractables and leachables subject quite serious, because we are also depending on the chemical industry, where we purchase polymer and plastic material. So we are in a similar situation as our customers are. And we are hosting and organizing extractables and leachables conference, and this year's one is unfortunately taking place at the same time as the ESACT meeting, so this time you cannot be there, but maybe next year it will be again in May or June. Okay, some practical aspects. I was talking about criticality of processes and risk assessment at the beginning. If we look in a biotech process, okay, we are starting with a cultivation, and then we are trying to get the protein or the antibody or whatsoever from the broth into the drug substance at the end. And as we have heard, all this can be done and is already done in single use. So that means we have a very comprehensive and complex process line where we have many different plastic materials, and we have different risk scenarios there. And of course, we can say that the risk is, or the criticality of an application is higher when we are in the situation close to the final drug product. So it starts when we are storing final API, for example. That is a critical application which needs special consideration regarding leachables, and of course storage of formulated drug product, and of course storage of the final dosage form. This is considered critical, and this requires specific leachables testing. In earlier stages, we have possibilities to do the extractables evaluation based on supplier data or based on model testing solutions. And the next group of criteria for the extractables and leachables assessment are clear technical and chemical things. So of course it plays a role what is the nature of the fluid in contact with the plastic material. If it is only aqueous based, then the risk is lower. If there are organic substances in a buffer system or whatsoever, then there is definitively a higher risk that extractables are leached out. Then we have to consider the general compatibility of the plastic material. If we speak about PTFE or if we have a silicone or rubber material, makes a difference. And most important criteria to determine or to influence leaching is, of course, contact time and temperature. So if we are storing API for years in a plastic bag, that is a different story. And of course, it makes a difference of if things are stored at cold temperatures, 5 degrees C, or at ambient temperature, for example. Then we have to consider the surface area volume ratio, it's clear as well, and the preconditioning of the plastic device. If there is flushing possible, whether it is autoclaved, is it gamma sterilized or ETO. Now, the last two slides are about practical examples. So that are generic examples, but anyway, we can have a complete single-use device for the mixture and preparation of buffers, for example. So starting with the mixing, then the filtration and storage in a plastic system. And if we have here up or downstream applications, and we assume that we have aqueous buffers, for example, which are not stored for years in the plastic bag, then we consider that as a less critical application. And in most of the cases, we can do the extractables assessment based on supplier data. The next example is about a leachable study for a part of a downstream process, starting with the chromatography column. And here in this case, we compared the downstream process with a pure aqueous buffer system and with a buffer system which contained organic solvent. And at the end, what is missing in this picture here, the API is stored in a plastic bag for 24 or 48 hours, and from this bag the samples were taken, and there were differences depending on if the pure aqueous buffer system was run or the buffer system which contained organic substances. So that shows us that we have to look into the chemistry of the substances that are going through the systems, and that we should follow the risk assessment rules to figure out if we have a concern or not. In most of the cases, we don't have a real concern. Even if we find or detect leachables, it must not be a concern. So, because it is not toxic and it is, in most of the cases, only very small amounts. Okay, then I would like to stop now. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you, Heike, for your interesting talk. Are there any burning questions that we need to ask now? Okay, you are welcome to our booth. Maybe I can get the last slide here. Our booth is right opposite to the large lecture hall in the Hofburg Gallery for further discussions with the speakers. I would also like to invite you to a virtual tour that Thorsten has already mentioned through a fully disposable facility. I would like to invite you to learn more about our newly launched products. We will show the new Biostat rocking motion. We will show the new DDCU stainless steel bioreactor and a new shaken bioreactor. And now I have to do some things here. I would really like to show you one. Oops, where do I have it? If you want to do things fast, so I would. So maybe I can do it like this. So when you come to our booth, you can win this little shaker. Yeah, have a look at the orbital shaker, and there's a chance for you to win this thing here to make your own cocktails. So that's what I wanted to show you. I love it really, and I said that I would like to keep it, but they told me no, this is really for our customers. So welcome. And there you can also see our new small-scale 2-liter universal single use. I also mentioned posters here, a number of posters that in one way or the other are showing data which have been produced in our equipment. So again, thanks everybody for your interest in this workshop, and also thank you again for all the speakers for the very interesting presentations.